I decided that this is the last lecture. I know that you are very sad. okay, anyway, so I don't want to... I will miss you a lot until the day of the exam. Okay, let's talk a bit about the exam. So I send you some the last four exams. So more or less they're always the same, in the sense the level is always the same. You will have like 3 hours, 3 hours and a half. It's open book, but okay. It's open book, but no computer, of course. That's it. So my suggestion is to go through those. They're not difficult, as you see. On the other hand, they are very easy, but one expects the factors of two to be correct, the signs to be correct. It's not that I start seeing the correct symbols is okay, no? So it's... another thing that I want to say is that notice that this last part about cosmology, I mean the thermal history, was not so developed in the past years. So if you look at the exams, many of them, they don't have anything about the thermal history, but this does not mean that this year there will be nothing about this part. Okay, so now that we split the course, we put a bit more emphasis on the thermal history. Okay, since I don't want to add too much, so today I thought, as I told you, to talk about rotating black holes. as you will see, there is nothing fundamentally new, in a sense. Of course, these are again solutions of Einstein's equation. So if you want, you can take this part as a guided exercise. But you will see that adding rotation adds some new qualitative phenomena. So the reason why I'm exploring this is also because nowadays, as I was telling you, the fact that we observe very directly through gravitational waves black holes, and we measure also the spin, the rotation of these black holes, makes a bit more urgent to know something about rotating objects, because they make quite a lot of difference. The metric that we're going to talk about is called the Kerr metric. By the way, I follow for this discussion, I follow this book by Hobson, Epstazzi, and Lazenby, which is called General Relativity. The reason is that, I'm not really sure, I thought I tried with so many, but sometimes Kerr is not very well done in very basic textbooks, because the algebra is a bit more complicated. On the other hand, if you go to very advanced GR books, it becomes really complicated to follow. So this is a good compromise. So there is a chapter about the Kerr metric, and there is much more compared to what I said. For example, there is all the study of orbits, and I'm not going to touch it. There are like 40 pages about this in this book. So the first part is what I'm going to follow, and it's kind of well done, I think. Okay, the idea is the following. Basically, one would like to follow the same prescription as the derivation of the Schwarzschild metric. But now we want to talk about an object with some angular momentum, okay, which is rotating around one axis. And this breaks rotational invariance. Of course, there is still a rotation invariance around this axis, but there is no full rotation invariance. Now, it turns out that contrary to what happens in Newtonian physics, so in Newtonian physics, whether you have an object which is static or rotating, the gravitational field outside is just given by Newton's law, so it doesn't care about rotation. On the other hand, the metric outside a rotating source is not Schwarzschild, and it is what is known to be the Kerr metric. So first of all, it's not Schwarzschild. Before writing down the explicit expression, let me, following this book, let me mention some property even before specifying the details of the metric. Okay? So what is you remember what we were doing in Schwarzschild? First of all, you try to use the symmetry to write the metric in the way you like. Okay, so let me first of all do this. So the general form of a metric. So, of course, let me be more precise. What do we want? We want a metric which is what is called, it's called stationary. And the axis symmetric. Okay. So stationary means that the metric will not depend on a variable, which of course we need to call t. So it does not depend on time, and does not depend on another angle, on one angle, which is I call phi. So the metric does not depend on rotation around this axis, and does not depend on time. Of course, this implies there will be two conserved quantities associated to these invariances. On the other hand, why I said stationary and not static? I said this because you remember in Schwarzschild, I was telling you that I was not considering the possibility of having a term of this kind in the metric, because this would be odd under time reversal. And a Schwarzschild black hole is just really static, so it's also invariant under t into minus t. Here, on the other hand, we don't expect this symmetry to be there, because we expect that if I exchange the sign of the direction of time, the black hole, or whatever, is rotating in the other direction. Okay? So this is what I call stationary. And in particular, there is only the following symmetry. There is a symmetry which, if I do this and this, then this is a symmetry. Okay? So if I change the sign of time, also the direction of in which I measure the angles, then I will get back to the same solution. What is the general form of the metric? Well, let me write and then comment. So, as I said, let me write first of all. Okay, so let me stress a few things. First of all, notice that this symmetry still forbid many terms. In a sense, I don't have any term like dt dr or dt d theta. So many terms are not there. But this term, this cross term, is allowed. Mm-hmm. Okay, and this is the one which will be the source of all the new phenomenology for this rotating matrix. The functions a, b, c, and d cannot depend on time and phi, so they will be functions of r and theta. Yeah, so this is the most general form of the metric. I mean, it's considerably more complicated than in the case of Schwarzschild, because you have four functions depending on two variables, so it's not easy. Okay, let me first of all explain what kind of, even before specifying the functions, what kind of new phenomenology arises in these metrics. So, first of all, let me write what is called the dragging of inertial frames. I'm not sure, I mean, I don't like too much these names, but this is the way. I mean, so, let's consider, so there is I mean, apart from word, let me follow the algebra and you will see what happens. So there are two conserved quantities in this geometry. So I'm looking at a particle which is moving in this geometry. I know that there are two conserved quantities which are P phi and P t. Okay, so the two momenta with lower index associated with these two variables because the metric does not depend neither on t nor on phi. So these are both constant. So now let's take a particle with p phi equal to zero. So this means, I'm going to assume, of course, we're going to see that it's true, that this metric asymptotically becomes Minkowski, far away from the object. So p phi equal to zero means that I have a particle which is shot towards the center of the geometry, so it has no angular momentum, okay? So it starts with this quantity equal to zero. There's zero angular momentum. Now let me calculate, on the other hand, this of course is different from zero and it's conserved in this geometry. Now let me write the corresponding quantity with upper index. Okay, so this is in general, I have this and this. Oh, sorry. And this is, it's the same, so it's GTT PT plus GT. Phi P phi. Okay? So this in general. But now let's focus on this particle. So a particle which is shot from infinity with zero angular momentum. So this is zero and this is zero. So if I now calculate d phi in dt. This is also P phi over PT. Okay, so D phi in DT is D phi into D lambda or D tau, which is the parametrization of the word line, and the same for the denominator, so I get this. But this is equal to this ratio, since I assume the PT equal to zero. So this is equal to G phi T over GTT. Let me pause for a second. I will skip a bit of algebra. I mean, it's not so complicated, but one thing that I want to notice is the following. In most of the metric we studied, the metric is diagonal. So the inverse of the metric is very easy, so you just take it. Now it's not diagonal. Okay. So of course, the 2x2 block T phi is minus A plus b omega squared, then there is a cross term which is minus omega b, and then there is b omega squared. Sorry, b, that's it. Yeah, so I'm just saying, of course, when I write this inverse metric, you have to calculate the inverse here. I mean, it's very easy, but just not to get confused. And if you do it, the inverse g phi t is omega 1 over a, UF is that, and GTT is A inverse. So this is equal to omega. Okay. So apart from the calculation, what is the message? The message is that the geometry. So even if the particle starts with zero angular momentum, it will start rotating together with the geometry. Okay? So even if I start with zero angular momentum, phi will start depending on time. Notice that this is a function of theta and r. So in some sense, as we see many examples, this geometry, I mean, the space-time itself is in some sense rotating, so that a particle, even if it drops from infinity with zero angular momentum, I mean, in Newtonian physics, it will not acquire any angular momentum. Here, it starts rotating in the same sense as the black hole. Okay? So, and this omega will depend on theta and r, which are the variables that we use. Okay, so this,
you mean the geodesic would be like a particle rotating around?
Yes, I mean that phi will start depending on time. Mm-hmm. Yes, so it will start rotating around.
And an observer, I mean, I know. So what an external observer to the metric, I don't know, in the infinite, it would see like the object release?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, this is the first, this is the first, I mean, I'm going to go through things which are different from what you expect for a non-rotating case. Okay, this one. Then there is another one. So you will see there are many interesting things going on. So I leave the metric so that. So another another concept is the concept of stationary limit surface. So here, the thing is very easy. You read it from here. Of course, I have to verify what the function A and B are doing. But what I want to stress is the following, that imagine that this quantity becomes positive. Okay. So of course, this quantity depends on r and theta. And I will have to choose, I have to study an explicit solution, but let's imagine that this contribution wins against A, and this quantity becomes positive. So when this becomes positive, it means that an observer cannot stay at fixed r, theta, and phi, because if you stay at fixed r, theta, and phi, you only move in t, but this became a space-like direction, okay? So when this becomes negative, you cannot stay at fixed r, theta, and phi. And the way to keep the velocity time-like is to start moving in the theta direction, okay?
You said when that the first entry is, I mean, the one that corresponds to time is positive.
Yes. When this becomes positive, that is to say the wrong sign compared to, so I'm saying this because it uses the other signature of the metric. So, when this changes sign, it's impossible for any observer to stay at fixed r, theta, and phi.
Geodesic.
Not even a geodesic. Even if you have an infinite, so forget about the geodesic. For any observer, no matter what is its acceleration, the four velocity must be time-like. OK? Okay. When this becomes positive, staying at fixed RT times phi means that you're moving in time would be space-like. But this cannot happen. Mm-hmm. And the way to avoid this is to start moving in phi. Okay, because this is so the other terms are positive definite. This matrix has still a direction which is negative, but you have to move in the angular variable. So the message is that below this surface, any observer must rotate together with the black hole. Okay? That's why it's called the stationary limit surface. And this happens, so the limit is when GTT becomes equal to zero. So if you remember, now, so let me stress, many of these objects, right, first of all, let me draw this. So if I draw in the plane T phi the light cone, so let's take, for example, exactly the stationary limit surface, so this is equal to zero. Then the metric at that point becomes B d phi squared minus omega dt d phi. Sorry, it's a factor of 2 minus 2 omega d phi. Okay. So at the stationary limit surface, this is equal to zero. So the metric, forget about r and theta, it is of this form. So you remember the plot that we were doing in Schwarzschild? Now it's not the same kind of plot because we are talking about angular and time, while there we're talking about radius and time. Okay. But in this two-dimensional submanifold, the light cone, okay, so first of all, d phi is equal to zero, so the light cone is like this. So staying at the same phi is null, and then the other solution is positive, it's like d phi equal to 2 omega. So okay, you have something like this. So it means that, okay, of course it depends on this condition, but at the stationary limit surface, particle can, this vertical, eh? So particles can only move in phi, okay? And below the surface, when now this is positive, now this light cone will bend even further, and you have a minimum rotational velocity around the black hole. Okay? You cannot stay stationary. You have to start rotating together with the black hole. Of course, this kind of phenomenon is important only if it occurs outside the horizon. Because, of course, if some strange phenomenon like this happens beyond the horizon, then okay, it has no practical implication. But as we will see in this metric, this will happen outside the horizon. Okay, so there is a region outside the horizon which in which particles are bound to rotate around the black hole. There is a now what do I put in here? So it turns out that this stationary limit surface, which is defined by this equation, is also what is called an infinite redshift surface. What does it mean? Well, it means what you expect. It means, as we're going to check, that if you are sitting on this surface at fixed RT times phi, and you emit a photon towards infinity, the redshift this photon will get is infinite. And how do we verify this? So I want to convince you that the calculation that we did in SparShield also applies to this geometry. Okay, so let's go quickly through the. So you remember in SparShield, the result of the gravitational redshift is the square root of GTT. Okay, it is related to the square root of this quantity, and it works also in this geometry. Again. What is the experiment that I'm thinking about is I take two observers at fixed phi, r, and theta. Okay, they're fixed, and they send a photon one to the other. Okay, at fixed, of course, to define what is the ratio, you have to specify the state of motion, and I define it saying that the spatial coordinates are the same. Okay, so it's not surprising that these two surfaces will coincide because you know in this limit. Staying at fixed phi means being null. Okay, so basically you are doing. Okay, it's not surprising that this is a singular limit because to stay at fixed phi in this surface means being null. Okay, let's look at the ratio. So you remember the logic was the following: that the frequency observed by first of all, the two observers are staying at fixed spatial coordinates, so the only velocity is in the time direction, okay? And this is the normalization of the four velocity. Okay. Now, the frequency. This could be either observer or receiver. The frequency observed by receiver or observer is u mu, well, there is a minus sign, it's u mu times, let me call it p mu, where p mu is the photon momentum. Now, u is given by this. So it's only in the time direction. Okay. Notice that here there is no issue about of diagonal. So this is just upper index, lower index. So this is nothing but minus ut pt. Pt is conserved because the metric does not depend on time. And this also works here. So this is a constant. Ut is basically one over the square root of gtt. So I'm just repeating the same thing we said in SparShield. I'm just stressing that nothing changes here, which is, and the bottom line is that the ratio between the two frequencies is the ratio among the GTT. Okay, so it's just the same formula as in. SparShield, but exactly for the same reason, it works also here. And what is important is that in the limit in which GTT, lower index, go to zero, then this blows up and it goes to infinity. So this ratio goes to infinity. Of course, this also happens in SparShield. And this happens at the horizon for SparShield, okay? Because GTT equal to zero is the horizon. What is important here is that, as you will see, as I already said, this equation will not describe the horizon, okay? So it will happen outside the horizon. Okay? So that's why now the two concepts are different. Okay? So it's the same equation, but for SparShield, it also gives the horizon. Here, it gives two physical consequences. One is the fact that once you cross this, you are bound to rotate around the black hole, and quite in a way which is quite related, if you start sending photons and you try to remain at fixed spatial coordinates, you get an infinite redshift if you send a photon away. Any question?
What
question. You mean that it is interpret shifted because the photon never arrives to the other observer? I mean, you send the photon to the... if I am an observer and I send the photon to other observer, the photon never arrives.
Well, it's a bit... so I would take it as a limit. It's not that... I mean, also the time it takes to go away. Here we're just looking at the frequency. So it's very similar to, you remember what was happening in Schwarzschild. As you go closer to the horizon, if an observer going on, so imagine that an observer is falling and crossing this. So an observer at infinity sees less. So if you produce a photon every second, these photons will be more and more reshifted. So each photon will become of longer and longer wavelength. The separation between one photon and another will become longer and longer without limit. So in some sense, in the limit in which you approach this, both the reshift goes to infinity and the photon will never actually reach the infinity. Okay. Okay, of course, let's say if this is a singular case, in a sense, as you said, it's singular because first of all the observer will become null to stay at fixed coordinates, and also the photon will never reach infinity. But what is it if you, maybe it's better to think it as coming approaching this limit. It means that the closer you get to this surface, the larger redshift your photon will produce. And the longer time it will take for the photon to go to infinity. When you reach this, then actually it becomes singular. Okay. Any other question? Okay, where do I put this? Okay, I erased this part, but I would like to keep everything the same thing. Okay, let me erase this. But I keep this point just to remember the enough. So the final general property I want to discuss is the presence of an event horizon. Because of course, as I said, it is crucial that this relation does not coincide with the horizon. Otherwise, it would be very similar to Schwarzschild. So, let me remind you what the horizon is in a Schwarzschild geometry. You remember at the end of our discussion about black holes, we were in these Kruskal-Szekeres coordinates, in which there was this plane parameterized, for example, by the variable big T and big X. So there was this two plane cross a two sphere. In a sense, each point here is a two sphere. Okay, so just to say that. Okay. And you remember that, maybe quite surprisingly, the horizon was a null ray. In these coordinates, I remind you that the geometry was proportional to Minkowski. So light rays moves at 45 degrees in these coordinates. Okay. You remember here there was the singularity. Okay. Just to forget about the other quadrant. But what is important is that the horizon is null. So in this geometry, the horizon is the product of a two-sphere of given radius times a light ray, something which is null. So instead, just to remind you, so naively you think about the horizon as a place. Okay, so if I take not the horizon but a larger sphere, this is a two-sphere cross time. Okay, so it's for at each time it's a two-dimensional space-like sphere. Okay, but it's a sphere cross something which is time-like. What is strange here is that it's a sphere cross something which is null. Okay. Of course, if I fix time, okay, then it becomes a two sphere, but it's null. Okay. And of course, this is the defining property of the horizon, because being null, locally, so if imagine that you take the light cone at one of these points, okay, of course it is tangent by definition of being null, it's tangent to the surface. So this means that you cannot cross, you can only cross the surface in one direction, like this. You cannot cross it in the other direction because this is already null, so the light cone is tangent to this. Okay. I'm saying this to say that we're going to see the properly the metric, but if I have to anticipate, the event horizon is a null free surface. Okay, so it's null, as we discussed. Actually, first of all, it's a three surface, in the sense, here it's a two sphere cross a light ray, so it's a three-dimensional manifold. Okay. And it is null. What does it mean, null? It means that, let me do it in Minkowski, so maybe it's simpler. So let's consider a light ray in Minkowski. Okay. For example, it is given by x minus t equal to a constant. This is a light ray in Minkowski. So I describe this to say a function which is x minus t is equal to a constant. Now, the gradient of this function is null, meaning that, well, you can do it, no? So this is 1 minus 1, if you take the norm of this object, is equal to 0. The same here, no? The fact that this surface is null means that if I define, for example, in this geometry, everything is only a function of the radius, okay? So, it's a function of the radius. If you want, in particular, the equation is r equal to gm. Okay, so everything is a function of the radius, and in particular. Now, the horizon will be when the gradient of this which is given by this formula is zero. Okay? Because in this situation I am exactly in this situation. Now so the same situation will come there. So let me say something and then comment. So the property to have an horizon will be that GRR is equal to zero. Okay. In Schwarzschild, these two things happen at the same time, because you remember, so GRR down is the opposite of GTT, so this becomes zero when this becomes zero. On the other hand, this does not happen in general, but these two equations are different, they are satisfied at different places. Let me skip a bit of complication. So in principle, you could say, okay, why you are only talking about r? Here there is also theta. Okay. It turns out that you remember, some freedom in choosing coordinates, and there is still some freedom in choosing r and theta, and the coordinates we are going to use are such that in general there is dependence on theta, but the horizon will be described just by this equation. Okay. So it's not mandatory given this form of the metric, but it will turn out to be given by this. Okay. Any question?
Mm.
So before getting to the
difference between the two, I mean, Schwarzschild and Kerr, with respect to this null 3D surface of 2D
yes.
surface?
Yes. Yeah, no, that, okay, let me first of all tell the difference, okay? In Schwarzschild, GTT, which is 1 minus 2GM over R, is equal to GRR inverse, okay? So, when this becomes zero, also this becomes zero. So this means that although, so all these phenomena happen at the same time. So the stationary limit surface is the same as the infinite redshift surface, which is the same as the horizon.
Horizon means GRR
zero. This, yes. So this all in this part of the blackboard and this one they occur at the same time. I mean, in the same position in the manifold.
But both internal and Schwarzschild.
No. So this only is Schwarzschild.
Okay.
Okay. As you will see in Kerr, I mean, this equation has nothing to do with that. So in principle, and in fact, in practice, in the Kerr solution, they will occur at different places. Okay. So. I'm saying the concept is that you should separate these two concepts. It's not obvious that they happen at the same time. Schwarzschild is too simple, so that the stationary limit surface, the infinite redshift surface, and the event horizon, they all appear at the same time, at the horizon, basically. Here, they appear at different location, as I'm going to explain. Okay? So they are different concepts. So the logic will be that approaching from the outside, there will be a region in which you are bound to rotate with a black hole, but you didn't cross the horizon, so you can come out. Mm-hmm. Okay, you are not inside the horizon. And then eventually you are going to cross the horizon, which is given by this equation. But they are two different concepts.
And the thing about the two and three.
Oh, this is the same. So this I was repeating what happens for Minkowski, sorry, for Schwarzschild. Mm-hmm. In Schwarzschild, the horizon, as it was. Clear in Kruskal-Zekers coordinates is a light ray times a two-sphere.
Light ray times.
In a sense, you remember we were using this coordinate e and x. Mm-hmm. Okay, saying that there is always a sphere which is not plotted, but okay. You remember.
More axis.
Yeah, there is all the radial part of the disk, all the. Discussion about angles was not explicit. So, at each point, you have to feel that there is a two-sphere with the radius given by, okay, the radius is a function of these coordinates. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, it's a sphere times this plot. Okay. Okay. So, what is the horizon? The horizon is this line, okay, which is not, I was trying to stress that it's not only a line, it's a line times a two-sphere.
It's a sphere.
Well, it's
a two-sphere. A two-sphere is really a two-sphere. Like
it's a two-sphere.
Something like a balloon.
Yes, it's a two-sphere times this. Times, so it's a three-dimensional manifold, no? It's like, okay? Mm-hmm. And it's a three-dimensional object. Mm-hmm. And it's, I was stressing that it's a null three-dimensional surface because this is a null direction, okay? And I was saying that what does it mean to be null? It means that the gradient, so this line will be described by an equation, f equal to constant. Okay. Mm-hmm. So in Schwarzschild is f of r equal to a certain constant, r is equal to a certain constant. Here it could be a function of r and theta, but it turns out to be a function of your r. And for this surface to be null, it means that this must be zero, mm-hmm. and this happens only when g upper rr is equal to zero. Mm-hmm. So that's why this condition corresponds to the horizon. Okay. So in Schwarzschild, they all coincide, so they are all together, but I wanted to separate these from that.
But what happened with the other null lines that you can draw? I mean, not all the null lines are horizons.
Not all. Not.
Yeah, because I remember that you can every straight line is I think it's enough.
In yeah, let's say in which the geometry.
In that one.
Question.
In that version, yeah.
Well, notice, for example, what do we want to draw? Because it's important that this also a line of constant radius.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For example, let me do an example of a null thing which is not an horizon. Well, it's an horizon. But think about a light ray in Minkowski. Okay. Mm-hmm. If you want, you can think about a light sheet. Okay, so you can put the other direction. In some sense, it behaves like an horizon, in a sense. If you have a light ray, you can only cross it in one direction.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is common, it's just a definition. If you have a null tree surface, of course you can only cross in one direction because it's tangent to the light cone. Okay, so this is common to all these surfaces, as you said.
Mm-hmm.
What is particular of this is that it's at fixed radius. Okay, so this is a null ray, but it corresponds also to a certain. So if I take t equal to constant, this is a two sphere.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this means that although for all these cases it's true that you can only cross in one direction, here it tells you that these two sphere
mm-hmm.
can only be crossed in one direction. So you can only enter in these two sphere and not exiting. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No,
I mean, I understand that you can only cross in one direction.
Yeah.
But the difference between the other line, the other null lines is because this is a big radius.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. It's a compact. So in Minkowski, for example, you have these light sheets, but they don't tell you anything. They just say that, okay, there is a light sheet that comes to you, and of course you can only cross in one direction because on the other end, the geometry is completely different because this is a sphere of constant radius, which has this property, okay, which is quite unintuitive. So it's a surface, it's a sphere of fixed radius, which can only be crossed in one direction.
Okay.
Okay. Let me now be explicit about the form of the metric. In principle, yes.
How are you defining a horizon exactly?
Okay. So I'm not giving a formal definition. In a sense, the fact that this local property tells you that it can be crossed only in one direction. But then, there are various definitions of horizon, but if you want to define the horizon in the sense that it's a portion of space that after you cross it, you cannot reach infinity, then you have to study the whole, the full extension of the geometry like we did in the Schwarzschild case, okay? No, it's a good point. So this will not, also because this geometry, as we see, there are two horizons, then there is, so this is, you find, is a local definition. And to convince yourself that a surface that satisfies this property is also an horizon in the sense that you are never going to be able to reach infinity, you have to do exactly what we did here, which is the full extension of the geometry. Yeah. So I'm a bit sketchy in this. And also because the full extension of Kerr is a total mess, which contains an infinite number of replicas. In the same thing here, we have a double copy. Here there will be an infinite copies, so it's very complicated. But yeah, so it's I'm a bit sketchy. Okay, the next step, I mean, now we just use symmetries. The next step would be to to put these ansatz inside ANSYS equation, and again impose that these are vacuum solution, we're outside the source, so I just impose that the Ricci tensor is equal to zero. This is infinitely difficult. This is what they say, of course I never tried, but you're never going to be able to do it by hand. So I just, so you can do it in mathematics, and that it's very complicated. So let me just give you the metric, and then we study what happens. So the Kerr metric has this form. Of course, as any other metric can be written in many forms, this is maybe the most useful. It's called Boyer-Lindquist coordinates. Let me write and then I explain. So these are called Boyer-Lindquist coordinates. By the way, this is not actually the only solution that you find. So you have to impose something more. And the reason is the following, that you want to say, so in your mind, you want to say that you are studying a rotating lump of matter, which is localized somewhere. But the way I put the symmetry, I could also describe, for example, the metric outside a cylinder, an infinite cylinder. Okay. So in a sense, if the answers that I make for the metric should know that I want to talk about something which is localized. It turns out that you reach this metric imposing some additional condition. For example, that the horizon is compact. So it is what you expect, something which is finite and not infinitely extended. Okay. So it's a unique solution, but you need some topological restriction. So you want to put by hand the fact that you are talking about a local object which goes to Minkowski far away in all directions. I didn't finish to write, because rho squared is just defined to be r squared plus a squared cos squared theta, and delta is defined to be r squared minus 2 mu r plus a squared. So the metric only depends on two parameters, which is not surprising, because there is the mass, which is related to this parameter mu, and the angular momentum, which is related to the parameter a. So there are two parameters. All the rest, so this rho is written in terms of this and delta. So the only two parameters are mu and a. Okay. Now let's study a bit this metric to get some intuition. also some useful limit. So first of all, in the limit A go to zero, the metric becomes Schwarzschild. Okay. You can check, it's quite easy. So you see that for A going to zero, R becomes rho. So this becomes what you expect, minus two. Basically, this mu is GM. Okay, so this becomes like in Schwarzschild, A go to zero, this goes away. This is R square over delta, but delta is for A equal to zero, is R square times one minus two GM. So you see that you reconstruct exactly Schwarzschild. This goes away, this goes away, so this becomes the angular part of Schwarzschild, okay? So this tells you that this mu should be thought of as the mass of the object, while A is related to the rotation. Another interesting limit is the limit in which I take mu to zero. So in this case, I expect to recover an empty space. Okay. So I expect that this metric is Minkowski, written in some strange way. Of course, it's not obvious that you find something simple. Indeed, the form of the metric for mu equal to zero is equal to this. So I just took mu equal to zero in that equation. This does not look like Minkowski, but it is Minkowski. But it's interesting to know, because it gives some intuition of this metric. So it's Minkowski written in coordinates which are related to the Cartesian coordinates. So time is okay, no? Time is written like in Minkowski, but space is written in some strange polar coordinates. It's written in sort of ellipsoidal coordinates. So I'm saying that one could check that this metric is the Minkowski metric, but instead of using Cartesian coordinates, I'm using these coordinates in terms of r, theta, and phi. So what are these coordinates describing? Well, let's look at surfaces of constant radius. Okay. They satisfy the equation of an ellipse. X and Y, of course, there is a rotational symmetry around phi, so X and Y are treated in the same way, because they are the coordinates describing around the axis of symmetry. So you see XY plus Y squared. But instead of giving rise to a sphere, so naively, you would like R to describe a sphere. So you do like an equation of this form. On the other hand, for a given R, they form an ellipsoid, because this R is a constant. So this is a constant, this is a constant, but this give rise to an ellipsoid. Okay. And In particular, notice that for radius equal to zero, okay, this becomes so z go to zero, this equation describes a disk. Okay, so let me try to draw what I can. So these are ellipses like this. So for a given radius, you have an ellipse. Okay. So bigger value of r describe a bigger ellipse. Okay. At a certain point, A becomes negligible and they become spheres. But for small r, you end up to a disk, which is this. Minus a. Okay. Okay. So these are. Okay. So these coordinates are a bit strange. They are using the phi angle, which is simple. They are using as radius the radius of these ellipses, and the theta. It's a bit strange. So surface of constant theta, they are like hyperbole doing this. Sorry, I put it not very nicely, but everything is rotationally symmetric around these axes. Okay. This is not really the polar angle, but it's something. Instead of being lines at fixed theta, they are hyperbole, okay, and which they close here, yeah, like this. Okay. I mean, of course, so the message basically is that you should always think about, so this geometry has only one rotational symmetry, so everything is sort of an ellipsoid and not a sphere. I mean, there is no reason which everything should be a sphere, and indeed, even the surface of constant R, they don't have the geometry of a two-sphere. Although, in these guys, this is Minkowski. In the limit mu equal to zero, of course, this metric is Minkowski, but written in these coordinates. Okay, let's now look at, as we did in Schwarzschild, we look at the singular places of this geometry. So you remember, in Schwarzschild, the singular places were r equal to 2gm or r equal to zero. Here, analogously, the interesting points are rho equal to zero, because this blows up, and also delta equal to zero, because this blows up. So these are the sort of singular places. It turns out that rho equal to zero is indeed singular. And you can check here that the Riemann squared, as we checked in Schwarzschild, blows up at rho equal to zero. So this is really a singularity. But there is a difference, because rho is this object. So for rho equal to zero means what? Means r equal to zero, and also theta equal to pi over 2. So you want both to be zero, okay? So where is the singularity? Well, it's at r equal to zero, but r equal to zero is a disk. Is this, is this degenerate ellipse here? Theta equal to pi over 2, it describes the outer rim of this disk. Okay, because this is theta equal to zero is this, theta equal to pi over 2 is a degenerate hyperbola doing like this, but anyway, on the blackboard, it coincides with these two points, But then there is, of course, a rotational symmetry, so it's a ring.
R, one question. R is the x-axis, the R?
No, these are the, no. The axes here are, okay, let's say, this Z and this X, the name of the axis. So R is what describes these ellipses. So for larger R, I go to larger and larger ellipses, okay? Mm-hmm. While this theta. Mm-hmm. So these are lines of constant theta. These are lines of constant R, while X and Z are the Cartesian Minkowskian coordinates.
But if R goes to zero, theta goes to infinity.
Again?
But if R goes to zero, then it's like X, then it's a circle with infinite radius or something like that.
So
if R goes to zero,
if R goes to zero,
then it will be a circle of infinite radius. Like a
so
plane.
If R goes to zero, this becomes so Z. So to keep this equal to one, yeah, for R go to zero, Z becomes zero, smaller and smaller.
Okay.
While this becomes A. Okay. So in this limit is basically Z equal to zero, mm-hmm, and X squared plus Y squared over A squared equal to 1, which
okay
is a circle here.
Okay.
A circle. And then this condition, theta equal to pi over 2, select, basically these two points are the singularity, but there is an axis of symmetry, so it's
a ring.
It's a ring.
Okay.
So there is a ring singularity.
But
yeah,
isn't this geometry for mu goes to zero?
Yes. No, it's a good question. So let me. Of course, this is the geometry. So you should not too much look into this. If you calculate the Riemann squared and you look at what it does, it is singular at rho equal to zero. Now you can say why. You look at this. Well, I look at this. It's just a way to. In a sense, this is Minkowski space. So, I'm telling you how these coordinates R, theta, and phi describe Minkowski space. Of course, this is not Minkowski space. So, I'm just trying to tell you that. The topology of this singularity is a ring, but of course the geometry is very different from what I show here. I use it as an analogy.
But the topology would be the same even.
The topology turns out to be the same. But you are right that I'm trying to tell you. So the point is the following: that in Schwarzschild, some intuition of flat space remains. For example, R equal to constant. These are two spheres, and this remains even approaching the horizon. Here, not even for mass equal to zero, the intuition, you see, even for in the absence of any mass, you are using the strange coordinates. So so that's why I'm showing this. I'm showing you that the coordinates that we are using would describe flat space in this way, and then I should just, this is, the singular place is R equal to zero, theta equal to pi over two. It has the topology of the ring, mm-hmm, but. Okay, these are the singular places. Then, what about the horizon? So let me erase. I erase this.
One question.
By
the expression for theta is like square root of r squared plus a squared. When r goes to zero, theta doesn't go to zero.
Sorry, say it again?
The expression of theta is square root of r.
Zeta is this.
Yeah. Square root of r squared plus a squared cosine of theta. I mean, you wrote it. You're just wrote
yes,
it.
Yes.
So when r goes to zero, theta doesn't go to zero.
No, look at this expression, no? So if I send r to, I want to keep this equal to one, no? Mm-hmm. So if I send r to zero, this must go to zero, otherwise this blows up, no?
But, yes, but just by the expression, no. Theta doesn't go to zero.
For fixed r.
For fixed r.
For r going, I don't know what to say. So this is the for the surfaces of constant. If I fixed r,
mm-hmm.
I have this.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm saying that if I look at, so these are ellipsoids.
Mm-hmm.
For large radii, they are basically spheres.
Mm-hmm.
For small r, they become more and more squashed towards this axis, you know,
mm-hmm.
because this is the inverse of the axis.
Mm-hmm.
So in the limit which r go to zero, the axis in the z direction becomes smaller and smaller.
By
how do you see that from the other? I have it here. How do you see from the other expression? Z is equal to r squared plus a squared cos theta. Yes, I think it has to do with the fact that that theta in this limit goes to pi over 2.
No?
There is in the limit theta go, I mean it's a very strange, no? Because this in this sense it's not obvious from this expression because you should know what cos theta is doing, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it has to do with the fact that in this limit it becomes singular, also the foliation using theta.
Okay,
so these are the singularities. Well, you're not surprised if I tell you that on the other end, the other point, which looks strange or pathological, it delta equal to zero is not a singularity. You calculate the Riemann squared and nothing happens. Delta equal to zero, which from this corresponds to the equation r squared minus 2 mu r plus a squared equal to zero. It has two solutions, which are called r plus and r minus. You see that for delta going to zero, indeed, grr, g upper r, grr is zero, because grr plus infinity. Note that this part of the metric is diagonal, no? So you have problems in T phi, but this part is diagonal. So this is the definition that we discussed of an horizon. So at these points, so for r satisfying this, the lines of constant r, like in Schwarzschild, they become null. So in the Kerr metric, you have two horizons. Of course, you only care basically about the exterior one, because once you cross that, you're not going to come back. Unless you are interested in the global structure of the geometry, what is important is the outer horizon. One very important point is the following, that this equation has solutions, has real solutions, only if A is smaller or equal to mu. Okay? So if A is larger than this value, then you don't have real roots. So if you don't have real roots, the geometry has no horizon, but there is a singularity. So this would be a very strange geometry, because this would represent what is called the naked singularity. Now, there are conjectures, but I'm afraid there is no proper proof, that nature will prevent formation of naked singularities. So these will be really solutions for which there is a singularity there, and you can reach it in a finite affine parameter, and is not shielded by an horizon. Okay. So these are believed to be pathological. So this means that if you want the Kerr metric to have singularities shielded by an horizon, the parameter A is bounded by mu, and this tells you that there is a maximum angular momentum associated for a given mass. So you cannot have an arbitrarily large angular momentum for a given mass. I didn't tell you, but the angular momentum, you should think about that the total angular momentum of this black hole is ma. If you want, is ma times c, the speed of light. Okay. So this is the angular momentum of this object. I'm using mu and m I'm using the notation of this, so there is just a g in the middle. So what is important is that the angular momentum of a black hole of mass m cannot be larger than ma, and a is bounded by, if you use g equal to 1 by the mass itself. Okay, so there is a maximum value of angular momentum for a given mass, and the black holes satisfying this bound are called extremal black holes. What is interesting is that astrophysical black holes are quite close to this bound. So the black holes that form, they accrete a lot of angular momentum from the infalling material. So this bound is not something very far from experiments. In a sense, people believe that black holes, astrophysical black holes, can be like a percent. They are very close to extremality, up to correction of order like a percent or something. So just to say that the geometry is very different from Schwarzschild. So it's not Schwarzschild plus a bit of angular momentum. It's Schwarzschild with almost the maximum angular momentum allowed by not having naked singularity in your system. Okay. So we discussed about singularities at rho equal to zero, and we saw that they correspond to a ring. Then there is an outer horizon. I forget about the internal one, so I take just the which of course will be an ellipse. I mean, as you said, don't take too much for granted this. I mean, so it would correspond. It's a surface with a rotational symmetry around this axis, which is not a sphere. Okay, the induced metric actually is not the one of an ellipsoid, but more or less you can think about it as some two-dimensional shape, which is rotationally symmetric around this axis, but not a sphere. The last point, point of the geometry I want to study is these stationary limit surfaces. I told you that stationary limit surfaces are surfaces with GTT equal to zero. Which correspond to this equal to zero. This equation, so you remember that rho squared is given by this. So the equation describing a stationary limit is simply this. Okay. So let's, okay, let me draw something here, okay? So we said that the singularity are these two points. Then there is some sort of ellipsoid which describes the outer horizon. Okay. Now I want to compare this surface with this surface. Okay. Of course. Also here there are two solutions, but we only care about the external one, because the internal one will be inside the horizon, so it doesn't matter. So it's quite similar. You see that for theta equal to zero, this equation coincides with this. So these two surfaces, they touch here and here. But you can easily convince yourself that since the cos theta is less than one, this surface will be out of that when you have the plus sign. Okay, so it will be a surface like let me sketch it like this. Okay, sorry for the drawing, but okay. So the message is that. The stationary limit surface, I remind you, the stationary limit surface means that once you are below the surface, you have to rotate together with the black hole, and also that on this surface you have infinite ratio to infinity. This surface is outside the horizon. Okay. So there is a region here which is outside the horizon, so particles can escape to infinity, but they are bound to rotate together with the black hole. So this region in the middle between the two is called ergosphere. Any question?
I got confused there. Yep. Where is the point where the redshift goes to infinity on the stationary limit?
Yeah, the external one. So they coincide, no? Sorry. At the beginning I explained that the stationary limit surface, which also coincide with infinite redshift, these are the same concept. It mathematically is described by this equation. This equation is this equal to zero, which corresponds to this equation because rho is given by this. And the solution to this equation is the dashed line. Mm-hmm. And you can check, comparing to this, that it is a surface which is outside the horizon. Okay? Which, of course, it's important because anything which crosses the horizon, you will never see it again. Eh? So the fact that this happens outside the horizon makes it accessible to the region in between, for reason that now I'm going to explain, is called ergosphere. And these are, so in the end, so these are singularity, sing, this is the horizon, and this is the stationary limit. Everything I said, there is also the counterpart inside, so the other solution of this equation and the other solution of that equation, but these are not really relevant because they are all inside anyway the outer horizon, so these are, I can draw them, but they are not accessible, so they are not solutions.
I have a problem with the intersection point, and how do you know that those two points are theta is equal to zero in these weird coordinates?
Yeah. I didn't say. So theta equal to zero, so for theta going to zero, this hyperbole becomes closer and closer to the vertical axis. So okay. Theta equal to zero is this axis.
Okay.
Yeah, so the smaller is theta, I have an hyperbola which is closer and closer to this axis.
Okay.
So theta equal to zero corresponds to these two points. So I propose, do you have a lecture afterwards?
No.
Mm. Okay, let's stop for 10 minutes, because I still have 20 minutes maybe, yeah, and then we finish, okay? Let's take a coffee. Mm. I can pause.
Mm.
Okay, any question? Yes, so the main message here is that is this picture in which, what I'm trying to stress is that the two concepts that in Schwarzschild were the same, infinite redshift surface and horizon, now they do not coincide. So there is a qualitatively new phenomena that has to do with the fact that there are these regions. Now, for reason that I'm going to explain, the region between the outer horizon and the stationary limit surface is called the ergosphere. Let me explain a process which is called the Penrose process. I like, besides the interest, because it's an exercise of things that we should know. Let me erase things. So the Penrose process, it's a process by which one can extract energy from the black hole. Now, I will comment at the end that, it's not only of theoretical interest, but it has some interest for, I will explain. So it's not only some GR exercise, it has some phenomenological interest. But let's explain what is this Penrose process. The idea is the following. What is strange about this ergosphere, this region, is that despite it is out of the horizon, it has positive, with the signature, positive GTT. Okay. So this means, anticipating what is the bottom line, that the conserved quantity associated with the invariance and the time translation, here it has the opposite sign. So it's not something it has to do with the time direction, because now this variable becomes a space variable. So let's see what kind of process one can create. So as I discussed, this is conserved. So let's imagine the following procedure. So I start from infinity, and I have a particle which I call A, and an observer at infinity has for velocity 1, 0, 0, 0, because at infinity the metric is Minkowski, so the for velocity is just is a fixed observer, fixed spatial coordinate, so it just moves in time. Okay, so that the energy that it measures of this particle is just the usual minus u mu p mu a, which is minus pt a. So what I'm saying is that this conserved quantity also coincides with the energy that I would measure if this particle goes to infinity and I measure its energy. So I'm there, I send a particle from infinity with energy given by this inside towards the black hole. Once it is here, this particle decays into two particles. Okay. So the particle A decays into particle B and particle C. Now, of course, the decay happens at one point. At that point, locally, it's Minkowski space, so there is conservation of momentum. Okay. So at that point, this holds. And in particular, so everything is at one point, so I can also lower the index. I have that PAT equal to P. So these quantities, which are conserved, they are also conserved in the decay. Okay? Now, let's imagine that after this decay, one of the particle comes back to infinity and I measure its energy. I want to prove that the energy that I measure once it goes back can be higher than the one I measured at the beginning. In this way, I have extracted energy from the black hole. So, the energy that I measure at infinity is PtB. So imagine the particle B goes back to infinity. So the energy coincides, as I was explaining, with this conserved quantity PtB, which is equal to the one I have at the beginning minus the one associated to C. And now what is the point? The point is that if this particle C does not come back to infinity, but falls into the black hole or stay inside the Argo region, inside the stationary limit surface, GTT is negative, or sorry, with this signature is positive. Okay. So this means that this quantity can have either sign. I mean, it's not an energy. It's in this region of the manifold, it is a special variable. So depending on the configuration, can be positive or negative. There is no, it's not sign definite, okay? So this can be positive or negative, depending on the configuration, because you should think about this as a spatial momentum, which depending on the configuration can be positive or negative. It has no definite sign. It's like saying the projection of the momentum in the direction x, whether it's positive or definite. Well, it depends on the configuration, but there is no a priori definite sign. So you see that if this quantity is positive, that is to say, if this quantity is negative, then the final energy is higher than the one emitted at the beginning. So the message is that since inside the Argo region the quantity associated to invariance under time translations is not an energy in the sense that it has the sign of a special coordinate, then there is no guarantee, and actually it can happen that this quantity is larger than the initial energy. So one can prove that not only in this way the black hole loses energy, but also loses angular momentum. So you should think about the Pankow process as something which extracts from the black hole both energy and angular momentum. And actually, the extraction is such that the black hole becomes less and less extremal. So that the bottom line of this process is that it becomes a Schwarzschild black hole, which is not rotating anymore. Okay? So you can extract until at a certain point the ergosphere disappears and there is no possible extraction anymore. So let me explain how you know that you extract angular momentum, because of course the opposite, you would say that you extract energy but you put angular momentum, this would mean that this process will go on forever because the ergosphere becomes larger and larger because you add angular momentum, but in on the other hand you lose angular momentum. And to see this, so remember that the particle B is now inside the ergosphere. Eventually, it will also fall inside the horizon. Imagine that I have an observer which is measuring the energy of this particle. So the observer is inside the ergosphere, so it's rotating together with the black hole because it cannot stay at fixed spatial coordinates, and it measures the energy of B. So the energy of particle B is equal to the momentum of particle B dotted with the four velocity of this observer inside the ergo region. The observer inside the ergo region will have a velocity which is proportional to 1, 0, 0 omega. I can put it ut here. So what I'm saying is that as you are inside the ergosphere, you are not allowed to stay at fixed spatial coordinates. You have to rotate, and to rotate in the direction of the black hole. So omega must be positive. Okay. So now we put it here, and what you get is minus ut times dt b plus p phi omega. Okay. And this object must be positive. So I repeat, this is the energy. So if I have an observer inside the ergo region, at a certain point I see this particle coming to me, I measure its energy. I mean, the energy is always given by this formula, because if I go to a local Lorentz frame, this coincides with the energy in special relativity. So this object must be positive. On the other hand, we know that this must be negative in order for the particle I'm talking about now is not the one that escaped to infinity, so it's the one that I should have called C. It doesn't matter, I mean, everything is symmetric, but since I said that B is the one that escaped to infinity, this is the particle that remain inside the ergo region, so I should have called it C. Okay, so this is an observer inside the ergo region, measure the energy of the particle C. This energy must be positive. Okay, so this must be positive. On the other hand, since we want to extract energy from the black hole. And the mass, sorry, I'm confused with the science. Yes, sorry, this yeah. So I want this to be positive. Sorry, I made a little mess because the book is using the opposite signature, so I'm making a mess. So this for sure we want it to be positive. No, sorry, but this minus sign is not there. I apologize. Sorry, here there is no minus sign in the sense that the metric is implicit. There is no metric in here, so. Okay, yes, so I want this to be positive, so this object is negative in order to have the parallel process, but since this energy must be positive, because this is the energy measured by an observer inside the ergo region, it means that this must be positive. Okay, so this means that the particle C carries an angular momentum with a positive sign. So this means that the process carries away angular momentum. Okay. So what? So if you look at the particle which comes out to infinity, if I start with a particle with zero angular momentum, the particle that comes back to infinity, it has negative angular momentum, that is to say that it's slowing down the black hole. Okay. You can enter a bit into the details and show that the process evolves, reducing the energy of the black holes, but at the same time reducing the angular momentum in a way that shrink the ergo region until the black hole becomes Schwarzschild. Now, okay, this looks like a strange process, but I'm going to tell you a situation in which this may be of interest, which is somewhat similar to what I'm discussing. People recently are studying, in the last maybe 10 years or so, they have been interested in the so-called super radiance. Superradiance is the following process. So imagine that you have a very light boson, and imagine that this particle has no interaction besides gravitational interaction. So it's the nightmare of particle physics, just a particle with only gravitational interactions. Now, this particle has a mass, okay? I'm going to skip many details, but in first approximation, let's imagine that it's a very small mass, but positive, like an axion, for example. This particle will form bound states around a Kerr black hole. And basically, some process similar to the parallel process will start happening automatically. So the mass basically prevents particle to go to infinity. So in some sense, the mass forms some sort of box around the black hole. And this kind of process will start and will create an instability. Okay? And the energy of rotation of the black hole will be converted in creating these very light bosons. And although it seems quite science fiction, people are using this to put bound on these very light particles. The idea is that, of course, the process is efficient when the Compton, the mass of this particle is of the order of the size of the horizon of this black hole. It's more the process is more efficient in this case. And people, what kind of observation you can do? You can look at astrophysical black holes. These black holes, they have spin. On the other hand, if this process was present, all these black holes would lose angular momentum, and you could not observe them. Okay? So the absence of this phenomenon puts some limit on the presence of these particles. In the future, since we're going to observe a lot of gravitational waves at different masses with great precision, this would be used even further. I mean, I like because it's very, I mean, this looks like only GR exercises. On the other hand, this kind of phenomenon find an application to put bounds on very light particles. Okay. There is a last point that I want to make, which is so in this course we never talked about what is called the precession of gyroscopes or precession of driving frames. Let me explain what it is. So, we are used to think about probing a geometry, sending light rays, measuring redshifts, the time it takes to go back, these kind of things. Another way to probe the geometry, in particular when there is this rotation, is to look at what a gyroscope does. Okay? So, a gyroscope, or if you want, even a spinning particle. Okay? So, instead of looking at the dynamics of a particle, I have a particle with a spin, or concretely, like a spaceship with a gyroscope. So, the gyroscope points in a given direction. So, in Minkowski, I move the spaceship or the experiment, and the gyroscope only points always in the same direction. So in Minkowski space, the equation is very simple. S is a constant. Okay. So I have I call S the four vector, which is space-like, which describes the direction of the gyroscope. So in special relativity, this is equal to a constant. This is similar to the geodesic equation. It just tells you that this direction is the same. Now, of course, if you go to general relativity, this equation must be promoted to something covariant. So if I have a particle moving on a geodesic and the four velocity is u, a gyroscope will just keep the same direction, which in GR means that u mu, d mu of s alpha is equal to zero. So let me explain once again. So in special relativity, I know that the gyroscope keeps the same direction. So this means that at each point on this curve, I can choose coordinates which are locally Minkowski, and the equation is given by this. So, exactly in the way we derived the geodesic equation, for a generic motion, this is the equation that the vector describing the gyroscope will follow. Okay? So the gyroscope is really, you should think about it as, by definition of this equation, a vector which is parallelly transported along the curve. And it's not only a geometrical tool, it's just what happens. So if I have a gyroscope in my experiment, this will follow locally this equation, and taking into account the space-time curvature, it will follow this equation. Now let me explain a couple of of course, these let me expand the Christoffel symbol, so you get something which is so this is the equation describing also the evolution of the vector describing a gyroscope as it moves along the trajectory xv. Notice that S is a space-like vector because it indicates the direction of a spin, so it's space-like. Of course, since everything is parallelly transported, if it is orthogonal to the four velocity at the beginning, it remains orthogonal, so it remains a space-like vector. Okay. Now, of course, there is a lot of phenomenology that you can study. In a sense, you can ask yourself, for example, what I want to be concrete because experiments were done. So the first experiment that you can do is to say the following. Imagine that I have a satellite which goes around the Earth. I put a gyroscope here, okay, and the guy is going around the Earth, and I want to know what this gyroscope is doing. In Newtonian physics, it doesn't do anything. In a sense, it keeps the same direction, it goes around, I do it many times, it always points in the same direction. In Schwarzschild, this does not happen. I mean, it's just an equation. You calculate the Christoffel symbols, you integrate, and what you find is that after one turn, I have the Earth, the guy is going around, and if it starts, imagine that at the beginning points in the radial direction, okay? So you can ask, after you do one circle, whether it points in this direction or not. It doesn't. It moves a bit in the direction of motion. And this is something that you can easily calculate. So you can find the calculations there, but it's just, you put the Christoffel symbols of the Schwarzschild geometry and you integrate over one revolution. So this happens in the Schwarzschild geometry. In the case of Kerr, there is an additional effect. So this has been measured with great accuracy. Another, if you want, is another test of GR. Was proposed many years ago in the 60s, but it was verified not long ago, like 10 years ago or something. So it is more. So this is the effect that you can find also in Schwarzschild. But now, let's do the formula. Let's imagine that I have an experiment that I do here. Let's assume that, for example, this guy is falling. Now, in Schwarzschild, by symmetry, there is no rotation because, you know, imagine that, this is the direction of motion of my lab. Imagine that the spin points in some direction. Of course, if there is no rotation by symmetry, there is no in Schwarzschild, there is no reason why this should start rotating. Because, on the other hand, in Kerr, since we understand that the full geometry is rotating, it's not surprising that this will start rotating following the rotation of the geometry of the black hole. And also, in the case of, for example, of the Earth is rotating. Of course, it's a small effect. It's not... but it is a rotating body, so there both effects are present, both these and also these, which of course for this kind of trajectory both effects occur at the same time. This is much smaller because this is only present because of the rotation, and of course the Earth is rotating in a non-relativistic way, so it's a small effect. So this effect is called the Lenz-Thiering effect. and basically tells you that the rotation of the body makes also the local inertial frames rotate. So the gyroscope basically is the most physical way to say I want to keep the same direction. Okay, and even if you are sitting here, the fact that this body is rotating makes this gyroscope rotating. So in some sense, it's dragging the Lorentz frame with the geometry. So this is something that also this effect has been measured. This is much smaller, so it was it's measured, but not with any accuracy. It's like a 10% measurement, so it's really barely observed because, of course, the Earth is not a very relativistic rotating body, but it's something that was measured. It's a long story. The experiment is called Gravity Probe B. It was an experiment that lasted for many, many years because of problems of funding, problems of sending on a rocket. There was the shuttle change of program. So it went on for many, many, many years. And I think the results came out in the 10 years ago. And also they had problems with the noise. So it was a long debate. But anyway, so at the moment, this effect is measured with some precision, while the effect, which is also present in Schwarzschild, is measured with great accuracy. Anyway, the message was that we didn't talk about that, but bear in mind that also studying what gyroscopes do evolving in a geometry is also a way to test the geometry, and particularly in this case of rotating bodies. Okay. I conclude here. Any question? All right.